In this video, we'll only discuss the 5 types of shallow footings, and in my upcoming video, I'll discuss deep footings. Starting with isolated footing or spread footing, this type of footing is the most common and widely used to transfer loads from small structures, typically up to 5 stories. Now I will discuss the steps of construction for isolated footings in detail, and those steps are pretty much the same for other footings. We start with excavation or digging. Then we compact the soil to provide a uniform base. The next step is placing green concrete, also known as plain cement concrete and also known as blinding concrete in industry. Those green cubes are spacers, and their purpose is to provide sufficient space or gap between the rebars and the lean, so the rebars can bind well with concrete. After spacers comes the rebar mesh of the main bars and the distribution bars. I'll shortly explain the difference between the two types of rebars. Next, we have column rebars and stirrups, followed by concreting and backfill. This footing is also isolated footing and follows the same steps. I've added this to show the distance between the two columns. The second type of shallow footing is combined footing. Combined footing is employed when the distance between the two columns is so little that their individual footings would overlap. Now I'll explain the difference between main bars and distribution bars. One way to remember the difference between the main bars and the distribution bars is that the main bars are placed perpendicular to the longer side and the distribution bars perpendicular to the main bars. Next we have column rebars and top mesh, followed by concreting and backfill. Here you can see the distance between the columns. The third type of footing is mat or raft footing. Raft footing is employed when the soil is weak or columns are close to each other, or when individual footings cover most of the ground. The same steps of excavation, compaction, blinding, rebar mesh, and concreting are followed here as well. The blue colored rebars are the main bars and the pink ones are the redistribution bars. Since this type of footing is typically employed for larger areas, they are more complicated than shown here, because rebars only come between the lengths of 20 to 60 feet, so laps are provided between the bars to accommodate lengths longer than that. The next type of footing is strip footing or wall footing or continuous footing. In this type of footing, there is a continuous strip along the length of the wall. It is employed to transfer small loads, in most cases, just the load from load bearing blocks. Here I have zoomed in on the angle of stirrups. The angle of stirrups is usually recommended between 90 and 135 degrees, but typically 135 degrees is used to resist earthquake forces, because they may open up during an earthquake if their tie angle is not adequate. The last type of shallow footing is strap footing or cantilever footing. Strap footing is employed when one of the columns is close to the property line, and in case of an individual footing, it would exceed the property limits. Notice the difference between the sizes of the two footings. The exterior footing, that is the one on the left, is smaller, and its column is at the edge of the footing. This position of the column introduces an overturning moment. To counter that moment, a strap beam or a tie beam is provided between the exterior and the interior footing. Thanks for watching. I really appreciate your support. Please like and subscribe for more.